इंजीनियरिंग, मैनेजमेंट, ह्यूमैनिटी, सोशल साइंसेज एंड अप्लाइड साइंसेज. द एम ऑफ दिस ट्रस्ट इज हेल्पिंग अदर्स विदाउट एक्सपेक्टिंग एनीथिंग इन रिटर्न. Surendra Group of Institutions has more than 2,000 students coming from all 29 states and other countries, many of whom are residential students residing in the campus hostel, which is built separate for both boys and girls. Surendra Group of Institutions prepared the student to explore the wide opportunity that future hold out for them. The mission of this institution is to transform the society through education, learning, care and research at the highest level of excellence. The trust firmly believes in all-round development of the students and make them competent and committed professionals who can cope up with the rapid changing scenario of the country. I welcome you all to Surendra Group of Institutions, where teaching is a gratifying experience and learning is an accomplishing experience in happy, secure and challenging environment. Now, I call Ms. Ankita Doda to kindly take the charge of the meeting. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for giving us this information about the college. Now, I would like to express a few words for our speaker of the day, Mr. Varun Doda. He has completed his bachelor's degree from IIT Mumbai and master's in operations and supply chain management from IIT Delhi and has a total of 11 plus year experience of supply chain management. He started his career as a manager at Wellspun Corporation, India, and currently working as a national demand planning manager, PM Fresh Private Limited. Now, I would like to call Varun sir for to start giving the information to the student about the supply chain management.
Can everyone hear me?
Yes, Varun sir, you are audible.
All right. Hello, everyone. Good morning. It's morning in India. So, let me just pull out the presentation. Is my screen visible?
No, sir, it is not visible.
Oh, give me a moment. How now?
Yes, sir.
It is visible?
Yes, sir. Now it is visible.
Perfect. All right. So, hello, everyone. Again, the basic purpose of this presentation would be to provide some information about what our company PM Fresh does. I'll take you through that. After that, I will take you through some basics of like supply chain, tell you a little bit about supply chain management as a function, who they interact with, who what they do exactly in a manufacturing environment. So all my the entire presentation from will be from the point of view of manufacturing only. After that, I'll take you through some one of the supply chain models that we use here for especially for the fresh food industry. So thanks, Sankita, for introducing me. So she has already given a brief introduction about myself. So I'm working as a national demand planning manager at PM Fresh. I'll tell exactly what we do at PM Fresh a bit later. I was working with Baxter's Food Australia as a supply chain manager. So they are also a food manufacturing company based out at Melbourne. So that was basically my first organization in Australia where I worked. Before that, when I was in India, I used to work for a company called Pernorica. Some of you might have heard this brand. They were the liquor manufacturing company with a well-known brand such as Royal Stag, Imperial Blue, 100 Pipers and Blender's Pride and so on. They was looking at procurement and materials planning. Before that, I spent like around 1.5 years at 2.5 years at Perfetti Van Mille, where I was the production and I was into materials and production planning. So Perfetti Van Mille is basically, they also have few well-known brands such as they were into hot boiled candies and chewing gums like Center Fresh, Mentos, to name a few. Before that, I was working with Wellspun Corp. in planning department and contracts management, where I was so they were, that division was basically doing all the small to large diameter steel pipes. So this is a brief about my experience. So a bit about PM Fresh. We are a privately owned Australian company, and we have extensive experience and expertise in fresh food industry. We have around more than 800 employees nationally. We are the largest private label wet salad manufacturer. What exactly is wet salad? I'll come to it a bit later. We are the first value-added leaf salad producer in Australia, and we are the third largest bag leafy supplier in Australia. We are the major supplier to retails. We have a large supply chain channel into food service, like we supply to Qantas in-flight meals, we supply to Mass Foods, we supply to General Mills. We also supply to, we have like a quick service restaurant customers also, like Hungry Jack's, Domino's, Subway, Pizza Hut and KFC, to name a few. So PM Fresh is the market leader in manufacturing, processing, packaging of convenience fresh food. We do ready-to-eat dressed salads. We do leafy salads. I'll show some photographs of our products so you would get to know them better a bit later. We do leafy salads. We do, and also salad kits. We do fresh, chilled, ready-to-eat meals, breakfast pots, fruits, snacking pots. We do ready-to-heat, fresh, chilled products. For example, soups, mash, ready meals. We do fresh cut vegetables, mainly for QSR and other industrial customers, which are sliced, diced or shredded. So this is a brief about our customer base. So Coles, Woolworths and Aldi are the major retail giants of in Australia. So we are the major supplier to them in our respective areas. We also do a bit of independent stores like IGA and Foodworks. We do food service like Qantas Airlines, Dinata, Virgin Australia. And lastly, we supply to some quick service restaurants like Hungry Jack's, KFC, Domino's, Pizza Hut, and Subway. So this is a brief history about PM Fresh, which started with Salad Fresh, turned into Mrs. Crockett, then renamed as Primo Moraitis, then Primo Moraitis Fresh, and now it is known as PM Fresh. The below will give you all the mergers, acquisitions, and consolidations that happened over years. Nationally, we have 4 sites in Australia. The largest one with more than 50% volume is in New South Wales, located in Greater Sydney area. Another 30% volume is made at Melbourne, and 10% volume each made in the Brisbane area of and area of WA. So, as I said, that we are the largest private label manufacturer in Australia, but apart from private label, we also have our own brand called From Good Roots. So these are the products that we do for the From Good Roots brand. So if you see the salad, leaf, and kits. So these 4 are the kits which we sold in the form of leafy salads with a dressing sachet mixed with it. Apart from that, we do some vegetable packs. If you can see, this is the pack of broccoli, cauliflower. This is the carrot portions, battens that we do. Then we have some salad pre-packs. The main core lines that we do are potato, coleslaw, and creamy pasta salad. We also do some bulk salads, which are like Greek, vegan bacon. Apart from that, we have some ready-to-eat and we used to do soups as well in FGR brand. Apart from that, we have these are the few products that we sell to a major retail called Woolworths. So we have some wet salads, southern style pasta salad, chicken pesto, chicken couscous. We have some Greek salad. We also do some ready to eat bowls and also some leafy bags. Example, a mix of baby spinach and rocket and Kale's locket. These are the few products that we do for Coles. Again, we do Greek salad, we do ancient grains, we do Kale's locket, roasting vegetable mix, Mexican style salad kit. We also do wet salads. We do some ready-to-eat bowls, breakfast pots, and some mashes. So these are the prepared veg that we do for our QSR customers and other industrial customers. These are the salad kits that we do in FGR range. This will give you some of the products with very, very low shelf life. So all these products on this slide has P plus 4 shelf life. P plus 4 means production, day plus 4 is after that. Example, Monday can go up to Friday. And so take this as an example to show how we model our supply chain, fast supply chain, to basically cater to very low shelf life products as well. So if you see, these are the ready to eat meal salads. These are the cut fruits packed into 350 or 200 gram pots. These are some of the snacking range that we do, carrot sticks, carrot and hummus. And these are some of the egg and spinach pots that we do for colds. All right, so I'll come to the supply chain model for fresh food industry later, but before that, I would like to take you through what exactly is supply chain, what exactly happens in supply chain, who they interact with, what is the structure, what is the KPIs and all that things. So from a manufacturing perspective, supply chain basically, so manufacturing has various functions in it, starting with sales or commercial, who are responsible to basically sell the products and also provide the demand forecast from its customers. Then there's the function called marketing, who are responsible for the conceptualization stage of the products. Basically, the product is the baby of marketing. Apart from that, there's a function called trade marketing, who are basically responsible for giving out all the promotional activities, whether it's retail, whether it's consumer promotions, everything. Like, they have a good budget which they spend basically to accelerate the sales of the company. Then we have a customer service, who are responsible to take all the orders and communicate back to the logistics team. I'll come back to this a bit later. Then we have finance team, which again can be divided into many functions like accounts payable, account receivables, manufacturing, finance, costing. Many functions in finance are there for manufacturing environment. Then we have operations and supply chain, which I'm going to talk about in detail. Then we have PD, which is product development team. Sometimes it's called R&D team also. They work very closely with marketing team to basically develop all the products, including packaging, cartons, and any other, like everything that's related to the product is being developed by R&D, or in other words, product development team. Sometimes this lies outside the organization also, so it's not necessary that PD and R&D has to be a part of that organization. It can be outsourced as well. Then we have human resource, who are responsible for hiring, training, implementing all the processes in the organization and so on. Then we have a projects team, who basically look after all kinds of projects, including launches, deletions, cost saving projects. Any kind of project you name lies under projects team. Then we have a technical QA is quality assurance, quality control team, who are responsible for basically ensuring that all the inbound materials are quality controlled, all the finished goods that are manufactured are quality controlled, all the HACCP trainings, everything, like anything related to quality falls in. They are responsible for the well functioning of the operations as well. So anything related to quality falls under technical and QA. Then we have a regulatory team, which looks after anything related to food laws, basically. So let's go deep into supply chain. And so supply chain basically has four verticals. One is planning. In planning, we can divide that into two parts. One is production planning, other is materials planning, or sometimes it's called purchasing also. Then we have procurement. Procurement basically is basically they are responsible for cost negotiation with the suppliers and all the basically all the commercials they need to negotiate with the supplier. Then we have logistics teams, which can again be divided into inbound and outbound team. Then we have warehousing team, which is responsible for safe storage of material in the warehouse. In a nutshell, supply chain function is responsible for maximizing customers' service level at minimum cost. Or in other words, they are responsible for the optimized use of resources. This part, I guess most of you must have seen these kind of graphs. So elements of supply chain. Supply chain basically is a function wherein the flow of goods, information, and flow of funds happens very efficiently. So if you see, the flow of goods starts from the supplier to the manufacturer, which are example PM Fresh, that goes to the distributor, or directly, sometimes directly to the retailer as well, and then to the customer, and finally to the consumer. Second part about demand planning, which is very important, and I want to show a video on that as well. The bullwhip effect. Let me just open the video. Is it visible, the video?
Yes, sir, visible.
And is the sound okay?
No, sir, still not. It is audible, nahi hai, visible zarur hai.
Give me one sec.
Yeah, now it is audible.
Imagine that with a flick of a wrist, you could set off a series of enormous, unintended consequences. No.
Replay it.
Imagine that with a flick of a wrist, you could set off a series of enormous, unintended consequences. No, we're not talking about Harry Potter. We're talking about supply chain. One tiny decision can end up costing companies millions. Let's take a look at what's behind this heavy price tag. Take your neighborhood grocery store, for example. One day, shoppers happen to buy a lot of a particular kind of beer. Suddenly, the store is sold out. What a nightmare. The distributor doesn't want to be caught off guard again, so they double their order, just in case. So when the distributor checks in with the brewery doesn't have enough. And they, again, double up on their order to the barley farmer, so they won't be caught off guard. It's like a crazy game of telephone, only way more expensive. Information is distorted, and the demand appears to be way more exaggerated as the signal moves upstream. By the time the order reaches the farmer, it appears that demand has more than quadrupled. That's crazy. That's the bullwhip effect. So, at its heart, the bullwhip effect is a communication and information flow problem. Link in the supply chain places their order on their best guess, which we can see makes mistakes. This habit of trying to forecast demand with incomplete information is reinforced by the operational silos that pervade supply chains. Because supply chains are run with inherent communication gaps, information often fails to reach the right people at the right time. Naturally, this causes a lot of problems for businesses, like stockouts, expensive excess inventory, Last-minute changes that lead to overtime expenses, quality problems, inflated shipping costs, and more. Now imagine if everyone could see the right data at the same time. No guessing, no information gaps, and all your products at the right place, time, and quantity. For more insights like this and tips on how you can achieve communication across your supply chain and learn more about the orchestration platform.
So as we have seen a video about the bullwhip effect, what that exactly means is that if all these four people, the supplier, manufacturers, retailers, customers are working in silos and no information sharing, the red line, which is very important, if they're working in silos and if they are doing their own guessworks, it will be very, very expensive. A, expensive. B, there might be some situations where people will end up in excess inventory or stock out. So it's very, very dangerous. And what exactly bullwhip means is that if there is a small fluctuation at the customer end, obviously because of the safety stock, the retailers will, the fluctuation at retailers end will be a bit higher, manufacturer a bit more higher, and suppliers much more higher than that. And just imagine suppliers of suppliers and their suppliers. So how many times it can, as you go more upstreams, it will be, the effect will be much larger in that case. So that's why this flow of information, flow of goods and flow of funds is fine, but flow of information is the critical thing in a supply chain. Moving on, this is the supply chain process that we follow. Any supply chain process has to start with a demand forecast from sales or the customer. Once we have the demand forecast from the sales or the customer, then the planning function comes into picture. They are responsible for doing the production planning, both long and short term capacity planning in order to maintain the service level. Then second, once the production plan is released, both long and short term, the materials planning team or purchasing team is responsible to raise the POs, replenish the stock holding that they have got for all the materials by looking at the bill of materials and ensuring that the materials are covered within the lead time and maintained adequate safety stock. Once the POs come to the manufacturing site, it has to be unloaded by the inbound team. Quality check has to be done by the QA team. It has to be stored in a safe way, and when required, it has to be transferred to production by following FIFO. And of course, some materials obviously gets expired because of demand fluctuation, FIFO not followed, thousands of reasons. Once the material reaches operations, it has to be converted into finished goods. So production KPIs include throughput, yield, variances, all sort of variances, material variances, and so on. Then there are some reworks that they need to do. QA, once the product has been made, QA team is responsible to quality pass that product. They can do many ways of quality check, including organoleptic testing, sampling, lab testing. Once product is made, there are customer service simultaneously in the background receives purchase orders. They generate sales order against that purchase order. They have to, sometimes they also have to do transfer orders within the sites, various different sites. dispatch date, delivery date has to be mentioned, the sales order, customer, when customer updates the purchase order, that needs to be fed back to the relevant teams. So once so customer service passes on that information to the outbound team, we are responsible for safe storage of finished goods. The orders which are received has to be processed by the outbound team, which includes picking by following FIFO method, then palletizing, loading to the truck, and of course again expiry happens due to various reasons, and finally the transport happens depending upon the product, whether it's ambient, chilled or freezer. So similar respective transportation also has to be chosen. Then it goes through, like there are certain mishaps that happen, which is like transit damage that results into claims. If nothing goes wrong, they have to be they have to have delivery dockets and proof of deliveries, and that's where it ends. Of course, I'm not going into finance part of it, like it is procure to pay basically, but like payments and all, I'm not going into that. So having given the overview of the supply chain, let's take a model that we use here at BM Fresh for the fresh food industry specifically. As I told earlier, that these packs has a 4-day shelf life after the pack day. Example, packed on Monday can be used latest by Friday. So these are, in order to cut short the supply chain, instead of supplying these to the distribution centers, we supply these, we follow basically direct store delivery, which is nothing but DSD. We follow the direct store delivery method in order to reduce the supply chain because of short shelf life. So we supply to three states, New South Wales, Queensland and Victoria, around 1700 cartons per week. I'm not sure how many metro stores we do. So this is the model. So basically orders are placed directly by the stores via electronic distribution information, EDI. So the orders are placed by the stores on Friday. We plan it the same day for Saturday production. The Saturday production basically goes into delivery to the stores. Few stores receive them on Sunday, few of them receives on Monday. So the last day to use that is Wednesday. So basically few stores just get 3 days to sell it, and consumer gets, I don't know how many days to even like consume it. The other set of orders we receive is on Monday, again for direct from stores via EDI. The production happens on a Tuesday, and all the stores get the delivery on the next day, which is Wednesday. And again, the Tuesday production can be used by has to be consumed by Saturday, like sold, all the things has to be done within Saturday. And the third production happens on a Wednesday, for which we receive orders on the Tuesday, and the stores receive them on a Thursday. So the interesting thing here is that everything has a set pattern, including when the orders will be received, when the production will happen, even the like to the last hour it is fixed, because there is a cutoff time at everywhere there is a cutoff time, right? So if I go to the next slide, So the order received on the first order received on Friday has to be in by 10 a.m. That's it. No orders received after 10 a.m. The production that happens on the Saturday, order has to be produced between 4 a.m. the production starts and 10 a.m. And like within few hours, the product is even dispatched in order to like no wasting of time. And when it is received at the distribution center, in this case, distribution center doesn't come into play, but I'll give you another model in which distribution center comes into play, in which the distribution center also has a cutoff time. So the truck, imagine 1,000 kilometers truck has to travel every single day, and they have to reach in a particular cutoff time. If they don't meet it, then the entire delivery will be rejected by the DC. So that's what I wanted to tell you, that everything has a set pattern, everything has a set cutoff time, and there is no change to that whatsoever. So this was about the meal salad that we supply direct to stores. The other model is where we are supplying daily deliveries to distribution centers. Now here, as per the contract signed between PM Fresh and the customer, the 48-hour lead time plays a very crucial role. So basically what 48 hours means here is, so basically customer gives us a maximum of 48 hours from order receipt to the delivery. Example, if the order is received on a Monday at 10 a.m., it has to be delivered, the product has to be delivered by Wednesday 10 a.m. In between, all the activities has to happen, the production has to happen, it has to be transported to the distribution center. As soon as they receive the stock, they have to the order has to be picked at DC to supply to stores in order to save the time and not waste any time, because all these are like shelf life of like 12-13 days. There's another term that is used here is MLOR, which is minimum life on receipt. Example, there's a wet salad, let's say that has a shelf life of P plus 13, pack day plus 13. When it reaches the DC, again, as per the contract, it has to have a minimum life remaining of 8 days, excluding the day of delivery. So basically, shelf life being 13 and MLOR being 8, product made on Monday can maximum reach DC by Saturday. In between, they will place an order with us. So now it is up to us whether we make as per forecast or we make as per order. Making as per order is less efficient. Making as per forecast is more efficient. But there are few customers which has a lead time. For example, New South Wales to Tasmania has a lead time itself of 48 hours. It takes 2 days to reach that. And since order comes 48 hours prior, by no way, and certain products are P plus 8 and P plus 6 MLOR, 2 days. So you can imagine the order received on a Monday, 10 a.m., has to be dispatched at 11:30 a.m., has to be delivered by Wednesday, 10 a.m. So in such a scenario, we cannot make as per the forecast because of the MLOR issues. So we have to make the same day. Hence, the production starts at 4 a.m. in the morning as per the forecast. Any excess or shorts has to be dealt with into different DCs. So that's one of the biggest challenge that we face. In few instances, we don't even get, with few customers, we don't even get 48-hour lead time. I'll give you an example. The Queensland DC places an order at 9 a.m. in the morning for a dispatch 11:30. 2 hours, 30 minutes we get between order placement, and the order fluctuation can be anywhere between, like, ranging from negative so much percent to up to like 500% variation. We have seen that. So basically, these are the challenges that we face on a day-to-day basis, and we get through daily through them. Not even the finished good. Some of our raw materials that we get also has MLOR of 4 days. That's it. So this was the two fast supply chain models that I wanted to discuss with you. So we are on the last slide now. So this I wanted to show you kind of warehouses that we have here in Australia. So if you see, once the product is made out of production, it is shrink wrapped. Once shrink wrapped, it is stored in this fashion in the aisles, in the rackings. Everything is palletized. Nothing here is unpalletized. This is where we get the raw materials. We store all the raw materials. Again, our suppliers also supply us in palletized and shrink-wrapped form. We store like this, separating allergens and non-allergens and things like that. This you can consider whether we are loading or unloading through trucks in such a form. I'm not sure on the chilled or freezer trucks, but yeah, there are freezer trucks also. Right, that's all I wanted to say. Thank you for listening. Any questions, I would be happy to take.
Yes, students. Any participant have any question? If any participant have any query, then can you please raise your hand? I'll unmute you. So, Varun sir, on behalf of everyone here today, I pay thanks for your insights today. The session was highly informative. Yeah. So, I'm sure that everybody far more understood about the supply chain management in fresh food industry. Students got enlightened, really enlightened with insight of your experience. Now, I would like to thank to our Managing Director, Mr. Gaurav Gupta, sir, our Honorable Chairman, sir, Mr. Suraj Agarwal, respected Executive Director, Ms. Rajni Agarwal, ma'am, for sparing their valuable and precious time. Apart from this, my gratitude to all the elite members for participating and listening with the patience. Once again, thank you all. Thank you so much. Yeah, anyone have any query? So, thank you, Varun sir. Thank you for giving this valuable information. Thank you so much for giving your precious time.